when one man is. And
are you kidding me?
From Combat Zone Wrestling from the CWF Rumble have come back into the Mid-Atlantic Sportatorium, but coming from the back door of the Dawson Brothers.
Give me that microphone.
Please don't.
First of all, I don't know who the three of you think you are, but this right here is our ring. You hear that? You think you're gonna come down from wherever you come from and take over what we're doing? Not in our house at all. You think you're gonna jump in front of us to get the shot at these tag team titles? You got another thing coming.
Yeah, you talk.
Kicks off next on CWF Worldwide.
It's all time! Let's go!
We kick off Ultimate Survivor 2016 with tag team elimination match. 4-on-4, when a man has pinned his partner, must leave ringside also. The match continues until one squad of four has been eliminated. And there we see the lockup. Zane Dawson kicking it off for his squad of four against Snooty Fox. Brad Stutz and CL Cheerleader Party are in the booth. And CL, our acquaintances, rivals, whatever they are, from Dojo Wars that we saw back at the Rumble, have returned here at Ultimate Survivor unannounced.
What? Who keeps letting these people in the building? After what happened to me on the last show, I am shocked that they are allowed to be anywhere near here. Why does this girl keep messing with me, Brad?
It's the Big Scare Dan O'Hare and Schlack on the outside. They represent Combat Zone Wrestling and Dojo Wars. They interrupted the CWF Rumble along with the Dawson Brothers last month after, quite frankly, repeatedly, we at the office received messages from them about coming to compete for CWF Mid-Atlantic. We didn't really want anybody from the Combat Zone, to be honest with you, but Snooty Fox is repping the CWF Dojo proudly. Cover only gets a quick one count. Now, once again, ladies and gentlemen, when a man has pinned his regular full-time tag team partner, must leave the match also, which means whenever the first fall in this match happens on either side, the other side will have a 4-on-2 advantage as Zane Dawson tags out to a man simply called Schlack.
You know, the only thing that makes me feel better about this situation is the fact that they are about to be eaten by the Sandwich Squad, and of course my boy Showtime. But I don't even know what to expect from this match. There's a whole lot of man in the ring there.
I talked to our boys earlier before we went on the air. Snooty Fox said he was so excited. Dirty Daddy said he was so ready, and the Sandwich Squad said they were so hungry.
Well, I hope they have the victory sandwiches ready, because I very much enjoy this. Yes.
Good Lord, he just ran right through Schlack. Schlack is a death match wrestler. It is not unusual to see him covered in the crimson mask. Mecca and Aaron will have to be careful. They hit this guy too hard, and our canvas here at the Mid-Atlantic Sportatorium will look like someone gutted a deer on it by opening up the old wounds of Schlag. Tag into the Big Scare, Dan O'Hare, one of the top prospects out of the Combat Zone Wrestling Academy. And O'Hare, I gotta believe, is really the ringleader behind this operation. Mecca drops him with the back elbow. And this is the second time, like you said, CL, that we have seen O'Hare, Schlack, and your buddy Riley Madison, the Hellcat, on the outside.
Now I know why they call her that. She's screaming the whole time. can't even focus on the match right now.
The Rising Generation League champion, the youngest vet in the biz, brother Dirty Daddy tags in on the arm. The veteran slowing things down. You always hear the old-time wrestlers say, if you think you're moving too slow, slow down even more. And O'Hare powerfully sends Dirty Daddy into the buckle hard.
Brad, I am very concerned with the Dawsons and their love of teaming with these people who are just hell-bent on destroying our home company here.
You know, it was weird. The comments from Zane Dawson almost made it seem like the Dawsons were a little territorial. Like, you guys aren't going to come in here and kick the crap out of CWF. That's our deal. A really weird dynamic that is unfolding. And, you know, these four men all just kind of ended up in the ring together. I don't know if this was necessarily the team that intended on answering the challenge put forth by Mecca, Aaron, Dirty, and Snooty earlier this week for the 4-on-4 tag team elimination match. Whether they were planning to be partners or not, they are now. Bell has sounded. We are off and running. And Dirty Daddy finding himself in the wrong part of town. He's got to get back to his corner. Good move. Good move. He got to the Mecca Mercenary.
Mecca looks hungry.
Mecca fires away on Big Dave Dawson, one of the most underrated wrestlers anywhere in the Mid-Atlantic region. Oh!
You know, I'm not the biggest fan of the Dawsons myself. Here comes Snooty. But I do have to respect them for what they do in the ring. Their partners here, on the other hand, I have no respect for.
Dawson brothers have held damn near every regional championship in the Mid-Atlantic except for one, the Mid-Atlantic Tag Team Championship. Virtually everywhere else they've gone, these men have been champions. And I gotta believe, I really do think it eats away at them that they have never captured. Oh, single leg drop kick from Dawson. Cover. Two. Only got two. I really believe it eats away at them that they have never captured one of the very richest prizes in tag team wrestling in this part of the country. Dozens of regional championships, matches, victories against the likes of the Rock and Roll Express, the Midnight Express, the Dream Lovers, and so many more. And yet, the one goal that has always eluded them, the Mid-Atlantic Tag Team Championship. We heard Zane Dawson talk about it earlier, CL. He feels like O'Hare and Schlag are basically jumping in line in front of him.
Yes, like you said, he's very territorial, which is weird because, like I said, the Dawson seem hell-bent on burning this place to the ground, but I guess they want that gold before they do it.
Nasty crash and burn there between Zane Dawson and Snooty Fox. Snooty Fox, the rookie, was wise to tag in the veteran Mecca Mercenary. Both men were jockeying for position a second ago, and man, it was a nasty crash. Snooty Fox may be hurt on the outside. He was wise to get, I think, maybe the unofficial captain of this team, the monstrous Mecca, back in. Oh, but they go to the knee.
Oh my gosh, Riley on the outside. I don't know what she's doing, but I've got my eye on her. But it is just madness inside the ring right now.
Dawson is gnawing on that leg of the monstrous Mecca, the 400-pounder. Schlack tags in. I cannot believe that we are seeing Schlack and Zane Dawson on the same team. Ultimate Survivor, the ultimate night of team competition where you see things that, quite frankly, you have never seen before, may never see again. Pairings and matchups that only happen once a year, like the Tornado Cibernetico that we will see later tonight in this hour.
And you know, you have to wonder, how well is this team going to hold up here? Because like you said, both of them seem to be coming in thinking something's owed to them. You know, the Dawsons, they really want that title. And of course, you know, we've got these CZW guys thinking they run the place now. A lot of ego on this side here, and I really think that's going to get in their way. Meanwhile, we've got the Sandwich Squad, Snooty, Dirty. They're a great team that, you know, they really work together. And I think it just comes down to respect for this ring and a better attitude.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think there's a lot of people, for whatever reason, that really, they don't respect what we're trying to do here at CWF Mid-Atlantic.
They're coming in trying to take shortcuts. They've got this girl in here to interrupt things, trying to shake things up. I think they're just trying to replace all of us, frankly.
Schlack got the arm of the monstrous Becca. You're seeing not a lot of teamwork, not a lot of collusion between these two teams. When Zane Dawson was in, hold on, cover, only a count of one. When Zane Dawson was in, he focused his attack on the leg. Now that Schlack is in, he went for the arm. Clearly not a playbook, not a lot of teamwork between these four. Gotta be the first time that all four have ever been on the same side of anything, and I really believe that both of these teams came here tonight at Ultimate Survivor to potentially take out the Mid-Atlantic Tag Team Champions, and quite frankly, I think they're a little surprised to find themselves on the same side of the fight.
Yeah, I mean, I can definitely see that. I think they came in with tunnel vision, just focusing on what they wanted, not realizing, you know, what was going to be in their way, who they'd have to work with, and, you know, like I said, say what you want about them, but they both really want this a lot, so it'll be interesting to see how they work together. Like I said, I think their egos are just going to keep getting in the way, though.
No water in the pool for Big Zane Dawson. Tag in Dirty Daddy, the youngest vet in the biz. And man, he is drilling everything that moves. Memphis punch, Memphis punch, Memphis punch.
Oh, oh my goodness.
Oh my God. Oh,
no.
Dirty and Snooty are gone.
Of course, that rule, that means Snooty's out too. So we're just down to two men against four.
And this is exactly what we talked about. Whatever duo was eliminated first would create a four-on-two scenario. Dave Dawson. Dave Dawson pounding away on the ankle. Mecha Mercenary trying to fight out of it, and Dawson goes to the eyes.
I am not jealous at all of referee Red Jones trying to keep all of these men in control right now.
No, referee ring announcer Randolph Hedrick looked up, saw Mecha in the ring, thought that was it for that team. A lot to keep up with in these tag team elimination matches. This, the closest thing to what some people would call a traditional Survivor match on this year's card. But once again, when a man is pinned, his partner must leave also. The champions find themselves 4-on-2, and Schlack about to get disqualified there by referee Red Jones. Crowd here at the Mid-Atlantic Sports Forum is rallying behind the Sandwich Squad.
And again, it's not just any four men on two. It is four men who are hell-bent on getting what they want. They're going to take shortcuts. Look, double team right here. I'm worried about this, Brad Studd.
Oh, they're trying to get the big man up. Oh, they couldn't lift him for the slam, but they got him flat on his back, and now they can just stop the crap out of him. Check out the thumbtacks in the boot of Schlack, glistening in the lights. Cover only got two. Every time Schlack leaves his feet, thumbtacks stuck in his boots from God knows when glisten in the lights. This is a dangerous, dangerous man, CL.
Yeah, I mean, I love the
Sandwich
Squad. He's trying, Arabic's trying to get the crowd. They're trying to get it, but I don't know what it's going to take to get these four men down.
I will say, though, there may be no better hot tag, as they say, in the industry right now than Aaron Biggs. He is who I would want on my corner. He is who I would want waiting to have my back. O'Hare mounting the big man, Princess Bride style, trying to choke him out. No, Mecha breaks free.
You definitely make a good point there, but Mecha has to get to Aaron. And look, he doesn't even seem to know where he is right now.
Boot got nothing. Mecha starting to rebound. Black Forest slam. Black Forest slam. He's got to make the cover.
Riley Madison not very happy about that.
He's got to make the cover. He's got to get to his partner. But to your point, CL, he's disoriented. He's taking a lot of hard shots. Mecha, out of desperation, hit the Black Forest slam, but he could not make the cover. He's trying to make it to Biggs. Dave Dawson is in. Aaron Biggs is in.
What is going to happen here?
Aaron Biggs has got to close the gap. The next pinfall, if Biggs... Oh, God!
Oh!
That's going to be it. Cover, cover. Biggs can close the gap and make it 2-on-2. Schlack's not to leave a man, though. Dave Dawson is.
Oh! Ooh. Knocked right off his feet, Brad Studd.
The big scare. Dan O'Hare shut him down.
Mecha Mercenary is still aware enough to get him out of the ring.
Yeah, great rebound from Mecha. Oh! Zane Dawson just charges, sends the big man out to the floor. Dave Dawson with his eyes focused on Aaron Biggs. We got a showdown in Central Ring. This issue really began with these two men back, what, 13 months ago at Battlecade, our anniversary supercard. The Dawsons have been nipping at the heels of Mecha Mercenary and Aaron Biggs ever since. Boom! Slugged him! Wait, hold on. Riley Madison just came right beside us. Riley Madison's got the Mid-Atlantic Tag Team title.
What is she doing with our title?
She gave you a nasty look, and she took the Mid-Atlantic Tag Team titles.
What is she? She just gave it to him.
Oh, dear! Oh! Backdrop driver! Backdrop driver from Dawson! Wait a minute! Oh! O'Hare just hit Dawson with our tag team title! Cover! No way they've won it!
Oh, no, this is not happening again.
Standing in our ring with our belts, and look at Zane Dawson. Oh, Riley Madison getting back in the face of CL Party, who has gone off microphone. But Dawson's and O'Hare and Schlack are about to go to war. Neither of them have won the tag team titles. Dawson has got one. Schlack has got one. They have won the match, but Biggs and Mecha are still the tag team champions.
14 minutes, 8 seconds. The survivors. The storm of incels and the Dawsons.
The Mid-Atlantic Sportatorium is the number one venue for live pro wrestling in all of the Carolinas. But did you know that you can also rent the Sportatorium for all of your anniversaries, fundraisers, and live pro wrestling birthday parties? Check us out at CWF247.com to find out more about how you can have your event right here at the Sportatorium.
See how I'm coming more like off my hip? You were like... This one's going up on launch here. It's the little things that make you money. It's the little things that make people talk about you. No matter what, it's still gonna hurt.
The rightful winner of the 2016 CWF Rumble. The man Dan Murphy of Pro Wrestling International made the most valuable wrestler of the year. Your captain, Roy Wilkins! Got show some respect. Get the damn man in his ring, show some respect.
Bell sounds and we are off and running the annual Torneo Cibernético, and Ethan Sharp, the coach's new lieutenant in the All-Stars, facing off against the coach's old errand boy, Court Montgomery. See how Party Court got his start with the All-Stars. He left the group years ago and now has seemingly been recruited by team captain Walter Eaton here for the annual Torneo Cibernético 8-on-8.
Let's talk about these eight-man teams here. We've got quite the ensemble lining up outside the ring here.
Sharp swings on Montgomery, gets nothing, drop toe hold, face first into the canvas, right on his handlebar mustache. Yeah, Walter Eaton's squad is lined up right in front of us. The All-Star squad lined up on the other side. I see Court Montgomery's new tag team partner, Callis Miller, in the on-deck position. Looks like Joey Rogers at number three. The Sea Bear is in this thing. Cecil Scott at number four, Rob McBride number five, Mark James number six. Walter Eaton puts himself number seven, and Nick Richards at number eight. Now, outside the ring constitutes a tag. Court Montgomery's actions have just brought in Otto.
Oh, no. He stopped celebrating real quick there when he saw who was waiting for him.
Court's got a lot of heart. He is not scared of anything. This is a young man that has dabbled in hardcore wrestling. Oh, trip from the coach. It was the coach on the outside. Otto smashes him with a splash. Two, got him.
Oh, but in comes number two.
Court Montgomery has been eliminated. Walter Eaton's squad is already down 8-7.
Court Montgomery's partner here, you know, he's
a powerhouse. Callis Miller will be able to match Otto for power closer than Montgomery was.
But it doesn't seem to be enough. Otto's still got him in the corner right now.
Boy, Otto may just run through this entire team if he gets half a chance. If given half a chance, the big man who has just migrated into the former Soviet Union from Germany may mow through this entire team.
Yeah, it's going to take some quick thinking from Walter Eaton's team here. And
they've got a powerful youngster, though, Sia. They've got a powerhouse in there. He might be able to throw Otto around, maybe better than anybody else on the team other than Mark James or Boogie.
This is very true. I mean, look, he's up right now. He's got him, but, you know, I just think Otto, look, there he goes.
Oh, he stuck him. Otto stuck him.
Otto's really taking his time here. He doesn't seem to be fazed or threatened at all.
Callis down. Otto, not only is because he's so big and so strong, but he uses his size, he uses his strength, he uses his body weight so well.
People really forget that the wrestling machine Otto has been in this for quite a long time. He's had a long time to really hone his skills. And look, I mean, he's awful proud of himself here.
He's approaching two decades in the sport.
But, you know, it's only been recently that he's been teamed up with the coach here, and it seems to be working for him. You know, I question the methods of anyone who would want to have anything to do with the coach and that horrible ring announcer. But, I mean, it seems to be working in his favor lately.
Yes, it does. Whether you like the coach or not, you cannot argue with success. Otto just mowed Callis Miller down with that headbutt. Oh, dear!
Oh! Oh, goodness.
Good Lord, that splash! Cover two, three.
That'll be it.
Callis Miller has been eliminated.
In comes Joey Rogers now, showing a little bit of fire.
Joey Rogers, the upset kid. He eliminated Eric Royal from the CWF Rumble in less than a minute. Woo, big drop kick. A lot of fire out of Joey Rogers.
He's still trying to find his footing, trying to prove himself here, but, you know, the crowd seems to be loving him.
Is just such a beast, though. How do you counter that? How do you do anything? Oh, Otto looking literally like a hairless bear. Just bear hugging Joey Rogers.
Do you think Joey Rogers can pull off another upset here?
Well, he can. He's got to get off the canvas if he does, though. You're not going to win anything with your back on the canvas. Sole survivor in this match will earn the golden ticket and any match of his choice. He's gotta get out of Otto's clutches.
Yeah, I mean, think about that. You know, if Otto does run through this whole team here, he's got his own teammates then that, again, have to face off against him if they want that golden ticket.
Correct. That will be all for Mr. Rogers. Cover two. Oh, he pulled him up. Has got two eliminations in mere minutes, and Otto pulls the man up.
I don't know how wise that is. I understand that, you know, he wants to show off here, but look at all these other men lined up on the side here. Not just like he gets the pinfall and he...
Inside cradle! Two! Got
it!
Otto has been eliminated!
By the upset kid, young Joey Rogers. The coach can't believe it!
Strikes again. They got to get Otto out. Red Jones has got to get in there and get Otto out. Oh, flag Balashoff. Hold on. No way. Oh, that's bogus. Joey Rogers has been eliminated.
In comes Cecil.
That is bogus, man.
Well, you know, he's Russian. They think smart.
Well, Otto is the first man eliminated from the coach's squad. I gotta believe they did not prepare for that, CL.
No, that's definitely throwing off their whole game plan. Coach was throwing flags everywhere.
So what is it now? Let me count. Let me take up a tally here. It looks like the All-Star squad is up 7-5. The All-Star squad is up 7-5. Cecil Scott has got to close the gap here.
What do you think of this young Vlad? We haven't seen that much from him.
Beautiful drop kick from the sea bear. This guy's a blue chipper. He's a hell of an athlete. Look at the hustle on Cecil Scott. Fired up, motivated. Cecil Scott told me earlier in the night he wanted to be here for Walter Eaton. When Walter Eaton was the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion, he gave Cecil Scott Cecil's only Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight title match. He wanted to repay the favor and be on Walter Eaton's team. But right now, Sea Bear finds himself trapped with Kabuki Knee.
There really is a lot of history if you look at these teams and the members, and I think that's definitely going to come into play here.
Swing and a miss. Beautiful drop kick. This Kabuki Knee is a hell of a prospect for the All-Stars. No bogus baseball player here. This guy's a serious athlete. Cover two, and only two. Now here's where Cecil Scott does not want to be, CL. He is, for all intents and purposes, trapped. He's got to get to a rope or get to his partner, or he's got to fire up on Kabuki. And Cecil Scott, he does not wrestle a full schedule. Is his cardio going to be there to withstand a beating if need be?
Well, you know, it is about the cardio, but don't discount Cecil Scott. He's still got a few tricks up his sleeves, I think. And
he's a tough guy. Anyone that has been a wrestler full time is a tough dude. This crowd is coming up for the C-Bear. Look at him fire away.
Oh, he's feeling it now. He's in the zone.
Woo! He's got to go for the cover, though. C-Bear's got to close the gap.
What's he about to do now?
Might be the brain buster.
Oh, Kabuki got him.
Cut him right in the sternum. Oh, roundhouse to the head. Roundhouse right to the head. Kick out, buddy. Come on, damn it.
Oh, it was a good effort.
Cecil Scott has been eliminated. Oh, man. CL Party, we are turning it back more than 30 years in the Mid-Atlantic Sportatorium. We've got Kabuki against the Boogie Woogie Man.
Boogie Woogie, Rob McBride, and he looks pretty excited to be in there.
Boogie, slugging away. Flashbacks to Starrcade 83 with the Boogie Man against Kabuki. Kabuki using those martial arts kicks. Of course, Kabuki Ni, it means Kabuki 2 in Japanese. This young man found by the king of old school, Steve Corino. And it was Steve Corino who gave this young man that moniker, said his style reminded him of one of the great Japanese wrestlers from the 80s, that old school style. Kabuki up. Oh, the miss!
Oh,
he got Boogie right in the eyes! He got Boogie right in the eyes! Are you kidding me?
No! The theme of the night. There's just so much going on here for the referee to try to keep control of.
Well, they got to get Boogie out. Boogie's hurt bad. Boogie is hurt bad. We got people tending to the Boogie Woogie Man on the outside. Kabuki knee spit that poison right in his eyes. Mark James is in for the Walter Eaton squad. And Mark James is exactly the kind of guy, CL, who could close this gap. Cover two, only two.
Yep, Mark James is definitely in there. He has not been liking what he's been seeing. And Mark James, you know, as he's been sitting out on the side, he's just been getting angrier and angrier. And you can definitely see he's trying to punish this kid now.
Yeah, that's a big, strong, tough man, Mark James. Kabuki trying to break him down with those kicks.
One might even call him brutish.
Very much so. The master of malice, the brute. I would not trade chops with Mark James. I would stick to the karate kicks. I would not trade chops with that big hoss of a man.
You know, once again, I have to question the intentions and the decision-making skills of anyone who aligns themselves with the likes of the coach, but this kid, he's got a little bit of fire in him.
Sunset Flip only got two. Jesus!
Thanks for coming.
Kabuki Ni has been eliminated.
Oh, and in comes that traitor, White Mike.
White Mike Jordan in against the brute, Mark James. I believe, if I have got the count correctly, the All-Stars lead 6-3 at this point.
Well, I'm sure Mark James will make quick work of White Mike here.
Thought that was your boy, CL.
He was, but you know, apparently he prefers sushi now, so I don't know.
Oh dear. Shot right to the face from the master of malice, the brute Mark James. The heavy hands of Mark James, former worldwide television champion, defeated a man now goes by No Way Jose in the developmental system for that championship. Mark James, a big bad son of a gun, defeated Chase Dakota to win the belt, lost it to No Way Jose. And that match against Chase Dakota, where Mark James became the television champion, one of the most brutal matches I've ever seen. Mark James landed, I think it was something like 26 unanswered blows to Chase Dakota in less than a minute. Just a nasty fight, MMA style, the night that Mark James became the television champion. This is a guy that can do damage quickly. He might be taking a little too much time here with White Mike. It may be cover. There it is. Only gets two. It might be in White Mike's best interest, excuse me, in Mark James's best interest to keep this thing moving and not be in a situation where you risk getting caught by the lineup.
Well, again, you know, this is White Mike's first opponent, but Mark James has already basically had another fight already. So I don't blame him for taking his time, trying to kind of relax here. And maybe he thinks that White Mike isn't that much of a threat where he can slow things down a little bit.
Good Lord, White Mike is screaming for mercy.
Well, I can't say I am not happy watching this.
The very first Torneo Cibernético in CWF history was at Ultimate Survivor 3, November of 2015. It has become an annual Ultimate Survivor tradition. Oh, heads up.
Ooh, that was it, I think.
That hurt a lot, I promise you. That hurt a lot. Mark James. Oh man, the deceptive agility of the brute Mark James.
Oh no.
May be about to take flight here. Oh, missed him. Oh, that knocks all the wind out of you. There's nothing you can do. You can't catch your breath. You can't do anything. White Mike to the ropes.
Oh my goodness.
Landed his cover too. He got him. Oh dear. Mark James has been eliminated. The All-Star team is mowing through everybody. Woo, there goes White Mike.
Counts as a tag, though. In comes Number Man.
Woo, there goes Number Man.
In comes Number Boy.
Walter Eaton is throwing everybody out, and he has got to the end of the lineup. Walter Eaton, in less than a minute, just went through almost everyone that's left of the All-Stars, and he is waiting on his former partner, the two team captains.
Coach Gemini trying to call time out now. I don't think that's going to work here. Walter Eaton is looking very focused, very angry. I mean, you know, Roy Wilkins, he's looking a little afraid here, I think.
Most decorated tag team in Mid-Atlantic history. Three-time Mid-Atlantic tag team champions, and they are about to square off here.
Roy Wilkins, I mean, I can see where he's coming from. These two, they've been friends for a very long time. He doesn't want to have this fight, but unfortunately it's come to this because when it came to choose, he chose the coach.
Roy Wilkins saying, we don't have to do this. You can just listen to me. Listen to the coach. Crowd is rallying behind Walter Eaton, two former Mid-Atlantic champions. Duking it out here. Eaton strikes first. He feels that it was Wilkins who betrayed him. Woo, flapjack. Eaton said that the coach had made a joke of the All-Stars, and he would not let the coach make a joke of him.
That's very true. Walter Eaton is definitely, I can tell he's been looking forward to punishing Roy here.
Wilkins about to choke on his mouth guard. Oh, Wilkins slides out. That constitutes a tag. And in comes Ethan Sharp on Walter Eaton, the tenacious Ethan Sharp.
And he's back in again. He's definitely had time to rest while he was out there. And he is definitely proud of himself here.
He's overly proud of himself. Walter Eaton standing toe-to-toe with Sharp and just mows him down. Just mows down this tenacious young man, Eaton, the veteran. Has won the Torneo Cibernético before several Ultimate Survivors ago. And man, he is just whooping on that young man.
There goes Ethan.
Now that will bring in Vlad Balashov from the All-Stars. And Vlad,
I don't think Walter realizes what's waiting for him.
Might be the Russian Sickle. Russian Sickle, no! Lariat! Wrote him down! Second one on the rebound! Cover! Two! Got him! Vlad Balashov has been eliminated!
Walter Eaton is showing no signs of any kind of ring rust or anything here. I mean, he's been gone for about a year and you'd never know it.
That's right, a broken arm suffered at the hands of the current Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion Trevor Lee kept Eaton on the sidelines for over a year, and White Mike, it looks like, is looking to make peace.
I don't trust him.
By my count, I believe that the All-Stars are up 5-2.
That's right, and so far, Nick Richards has not been in the ring at all, so he's still there fresh. The All-Stars are on, what, their third cycle now?
I think so. Now, this is an interesting move from White Mikey, back deep up in the inner corner. Eaton can tag out to Richards from that corner. Double stops White Mike's guts out.
That says a lot about Walter Eaton there. You know, he could have tagged
two.
Out. White Mike kicks out, though. What is it going to take to keep White Mike down here? That's what Walter Eaton is thinking.
To your point, Walter Eaton came here to fight. When they were in the corner, he could have tagged Richards in, but no, he has missed the in-ring action. He wants to get him some of the All-Stars. Walter Eaton feels that the All-Stars betrayed him by becoming, oh God, soft, by becoming what he deems foolish, and Eaton may torture White Mike into submission here.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, you know, Walter Eaton, he's here to punish his former partner, but I think he's going to take it out on anyone he can get his hands on, and right now that's unfortunately White Mike.
There seems to be a bit of a meeting in the far side of the ring of the All-Stars, a huddle, if you will, as right now Walter has got White Mike trapped, and he is telling Roy Wilkins that this can happen to you. Walter Eaton not interested at all in any kind of reunion of the Goon Squad, and Wilkins is on the apron. Wilkins is on the apron. Eaton tucks him right back down.
You know, I really don't think Roy Wilkins wants to fight Walter Eaton here. I think he came with hopes of still trying to make up, but very clearly here, Walter is not here to make any friends.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to fight this man either. Talk about a year or so on the sidelines. Oh, God.
Oh, White Mike is definitely taking a lot of punishment here.
Eaton looking to leave no doubt here. Backdrop, no sir. Wait, hold on.
Oh.
White Mike to the apron, not the floor. That does not constitute a tag. He's got to hit the floor to constitute a tag. Wilkins, no, Wilkins on the floor. Wilkins on the floor. Wilkins for the floor, and he got it.
Goodness.
Wilkins had the foot outside the ring. Walter Eaton has been eliminated.
Nick Richards is left all alone to face this group of how many men are left on the All-Star team?
It is 5-1 in favor of the All-Stars. Eaton cannot believe it.
Not only that, we got these two morons, the coach and Jerry Carey on the side here.
Oh, God! Oh, they slapped the shit out of him.
Yeah, he's definitely paying for it there. Yeah, Nick Richards is okay, and I mean, what option does he have at this point?
Richards is the last man standing for Walter Eaton's squad. He faces a 5-1, but listen to this crowd!
And, you know, I think what we've got going, what Nick's got going for him here, is that he's fresh. He has not stepped in the ring until this moment. We don't know how many times we've cycled through all the All-Stars here. He's just got to be able to take advantage of that, because unfortunately the numbers are not in his favor.
White Mike is standing up to Richards here.
I think White Mike is feeling a little cocky. He's gotten about two eliminations now, so.
Huge clothesline from Richards. Richards, one fall away are the All-Stars from winning this thing. Richards is five falls away from winning this thing.
If you're Nick Richards, what's your game plan here, Brad Stutz?
Strike fast and mow him down as fast as you can. Close the gap as quick as humanly possible.
He's really got to have eyes on the back of his head here. Like you said, there are four other men on that team, not including the coach, Jerry Carey. We've got a lot going on, and the referee can only control so much.
White Mike goes to the eyes here. White Mike, get ready for Richards. Could be the can opener. Yes, it is. Got him. No, swung all the way through.
Cutter.
Boom. Dead center of the ring. Cover. Two. Got him. White Mike has been eliminated. But the All-Star still lead 4-1. 4-1, and I cannot believe that the damn number men are still in this thing. The number men are conquistadoring their way into Ultimate Survivor record books here. I cannot believe that out of 16 people, the number men are still in this fight.
To be fair, their time so far has mostly consisted of getting immediately thrown out of the ring, so don't give them too much credit.
Be that as it may, though, this has got to be the longest that any incarnation of Number Man has ever lasted in a Survivor. Coming up is the Number Man.
Oh!
Drilled him with another cutter! Cover! Got him!
Number Man has been eliminated.
Nick Richards has got to keep up this momentum if he's got any hope of winning this thing. Oh, my goodness!
Into the cover again!
Number Boy has been eliminated!
It is 2-1! Richards has eliminated three people in, what, about 2.5 minutes or so?
But here comes Roy Wilkins, and he is no number man.
The former Mid-Atlantic heavyweight champion facing off against the man who has a guaranteed Mid-Atlantic title shot thanks to winning this year's Weaver Cup, and Wilkins steps aside. Wilkins has been playing defense this entire matchup. That will make, hold on, that will make Sharp legal. Schoolboy, two! Oh. Only two. That was great strategy on the part of the All-Stars, like it or not.
Like I said, Nick Richards has got to get eyes on the back of his head.
Cutter, no. Backslide. Richards.
He's going for whatever he can here.
Oh, he got another one. Good Lord. Cover. Beat him.
Ethan Sharp has been eliminated. We are down. One for the golden ticket.
Could there be two more different men in this finals here? I mean, Roy Wilkins has come back to CWF with a chip on his shoulder, trying to take anything he can get, taking shortcuts, really just expecting the world. And Nick Richards has been here fighting and scrapping for almost a year now.
Absolutely. Richards is on a quest to prove that he belongs with the upper echelon, that he belongs. And a win over Wilkins here, not only does that set Richards' point into motion, but a win over here gets Richards the golden ticket and any match of his choice.
That's right, and you know, it's going to be really interesting here if Nick Richards does win it. As you said before, because he won the Weaver Cup, he automatically gets a chance at the Mid-Atlantic heavyweight title. So what is he going to use this golden ticket for?
Wilkins on the mat will have an advantage. We have seen Richards use that dangerous cutter to mow down four people, just literally like a superhero in a movie who finally gets his hands on that automatic weapon and mows down the bad guys. Wilkins with the crossbody.
And like you said, Wilkins has gone through, I don't know, 4 or 5 men at this point. He's really feeling it right now. Roy came into this a little bit fresher than him. You know, he's worked pretty hard in this, but he's definitely spent most of his time down on the sidelines, and he was ready for Nick Richards.
Wilkins stalking Richards on the far side.
I don't think the corner is where Nick Richards wants to be right now. This is definitely not looking good for him.
Come on, Roy, you got it now. Wilkins standing over Richards. Richards has been on a quest all year long. Oh, Canadian Destroyer will be a disqualification. Canadian Destroyer will be a disqualification right in front of the referees. I don't know what the hell Wilkins was thinking there.
Nick Richards didn't give him the opportunity to do whatever it was, though. Chopping away at him. And you know, as we talked about before, you know, whereas before the strategy is just as fast as you can, these two can really take their time now to make the match that works best for them. And right now, Nick Richards has control.
Absolutely. No time limit. These two fight to a finish. And the winner gets the golden ticket. Now let's talk about this. Richards has a guaranteed title shot against the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion by virtue of winning the Weaver Cup. If Richards leaves here with the golden ticket, he can make that title match anything he wants. No disqualification, street fight, barbed wire. Richards has survived the craziest matches in CWF history, and if he wins the golden ticket, he could utilize it for that guaranteed title shot. Roy Wilkins has just come back to CWF Mid-Atlantic. You gotta think he would love to be Mid-Atlantic champion again. That golden ticket means anything. A match with someone like Walter Eaton to force him to leave CWF Mid-Atlantic. A match with someone like Trevor Lee that could potentially force him to leave CWF Mid-Atlantic. The All-Stars, historically, have been very creative with the golden ticket in years past.
And that's definitely something you've got to keep in mind. You know, a win here for Wilkins doesn't just mean the golden ticket is in Wilkins' hands, it means it's in the coach's hands, and he is very good at getting what he wants, unfortunately.
Wilkins has held the golden ticket one time before. It was Battle Bowl 2014. He used the golden ticket to cash in on Eric Royal and end the longest title reign in CWF history. I'm going to say that again. The last time that the golden ticket was in Roy Wilkins' hands, he used it to beat the seemingly unbeatable Eric Royal and capture the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Championship for the first time in his career. Wilkins, you've got to believe in the hands of someone like Wilkins who can fight, who can wrestle, who can fly, who can do it all. That golden ticket means literally anything.
And you know, that is what is so frustrating about Roy Wilkins. Like you said, he can fight, he can fly, he can do it all, and yet he still hides behind the coach and uses all these shortcuts, anything he can to get ahead. He doesn't need that. Like you said, the last time he had the golden ticket, he cashed it in on Eric Royal. He probably could have won it on his own, but instead, you know, he had to cheat and use all of these. It was just a horrible thing to watch, and I hate to see what could happen if he gets that kind of power again.
We have seen the golden ticket cashed in to win championships. We have seen it cashed in to settle heated personal issues. We have seen pretty much any, it's almost like having your dream match, any opponents, any stipulations. Wilkins right now is taking advantage of a loophole in the cybernetical rules. There's no count out because theoretically going to the floor constitutes a tag. So there's no count out. They can brawl out there forever.
That's right. Once again, he is just taking advantage any way he can. And you know, as much as I would hate to see the golden ticket in someone like Roy Wilkins' hands, you have to wonder, the demented mind of Nick Richards, given any chance to do what he can.
Richards going for the cactus. Oh, left right over the coach.
Coach definitely ducked out of the way there. He knew what was coming.
Crowd is rallying behind Richards.
Nick Richards does not care who gets in his way. And again, it's that mindset that has me wondering, if he wins the golden ticket, what on earth is he going to come up with? What is he going to do with it?
Richards standing tall. Where's the damn number man and number boy are in the ring? There's no disqualification, but we gotta get these two goofballs out of here.
Referee Kevin Pierce really has to get control back in this match.
Wilkins could be disqualified right here. Get him out.
This is not good for Nick Richards.
Richards fighting him off here.
All this is doing is buying Roy Wilkins more time.
That's exactly what it's doing. Coach is using the numbers game. Coach is trying to use the numbers game. He's calling for help.
Oh, my gosh! Thank you, Nick Richards!
Good grief!
Oh, I hope he damaged his vocal cords.
Wilkins, hold on, schoolboy! Got the tights! Got it!
No.
Your winner of the 2016 Torneo Cibernetico! For the All-Stars, Roy Wilkins!
After an incredibly grueling fight, Wilkins and the All-Stars, there's just too many of them, one step ahead of Nick Richards, and all of the power is in the hands of Wilkins.
It happens.